Could use some like wrestling style pump up music. But thanks for coming out, guys. We're gonna go ahead and get the panel started here today, talking about the smart home. My name is Rye Crist. I'm a senior associate editor at CNET and part of the CNET smart home project. So we test a lot of smart home gadgets and write a lot about where the smart home is at and where it might be headed. So I could not be more excited to be moderating this panel with four very distinguished panelists that have great perspectives on the topic at hand. So just a quick run through to go through who we're talking to today. We've got Miles Kingston from Intel here. Miles is, just to make sure I get the job title exactly right, the general manager of Intel's smart home group. So it's got a great perspective on what Intel is doing to kind of power the smart home with their hardware and chipsets and things like that. We have Dan DeClerico beside him. He's from Home Advisor, formerly of Consumer Reports and Martha Stewart Living and This Old House. A lot of experience writing about what goes into our homes and the technology that can make our homes more interesting and more pleasant to live in and more profitable to sell. So great perspectives there. We have Alex Capasalatro from Josh AI. Some people call him Josh. He's the CEO of Josh AI and the developer of some very interesting artificial intelligence software that powers a really cool home automation system that has an award-winning new product here at CEDIA this year. So we'll hear more about that in just a bit. And then finally, we have Walt Zerbe from CEDIA. He is, again, to get the job title just right, Senior Director of Technology and Standards for CEDIA this year, just joining that position. So I have a lot to hear from him as well. But to get started, I just want to go down the line and kind of start with Miles here. So what I wrote down for Miles. Miles, you know, people think about Intel and they often think about computers. And Miles has a background working at desktop PCs at Intel, but is now, you know, directing their smart home group. But Intel hardware, as I mentioned, is, you know, all over the place when it comes to the smart home. Just look at the Amazon Echo Show that came out this summer. Their touchscreen Alexa device has the Intel Atom X5 Z8350 inside of it. And you know, Miles has done a lot of kind of thinking and writing about the smart home, and that's sort of his job for Intel. So I wanted to start by just asking Miles, what have you been thinking about lately? What's the strategy for Intel as the smart home continues to expand?
Right. So I've been at Intel about 18 years. I used to run the consumer desktop business for Intel about 5 years ago, and that's when we really started looking at the smart home. And what we were looking at is all the new devices coming into the home, all of the new use cases, all of the amount of data that's going to be created in the home, and how it could be, you know, something that an idle PC in the home could start adding value there. We're still very focused on that, but what we've started to turn to as well is, you know, a lot of companies like Amazon with the Echo, they're coming with purpose-built devices to go really enable these smart home experiences. So we're also very heavily focused on winning their business and then helping create some scale. And when you talk about you know, the types of roles Intel has played in the past, if we look at the PC business, we make our money selling silicon, that's our business, but what we tried to do with the PC business as well is help create industry standards on software, industry standards on hardware, to make these horizontal building blocks to make it easier for the ecosystem to participate and allow more customers to come into the business, and again, and that bet our business model. It's that same thing we're now trying to do with smart home, is come in and see what role we can play to help establish standards, you know, create some standard pieces of hardware. We've announced some reference designs for smart speakers, so if a customer wants to make their own branded smart speaker, we've taken 80% of the engineering work out of that, and you can buy it and skin it and sell it yourself. So that's kind of the focus on the smart home we have right now.
You know, the official title of this panel is talking about the smart home misnomer, the idea that we want more intelligent homes, yeah, not just smart with a lowercase s, so to speak. And you know, one of the things you've written is that the foundational technologies you're working on can transform the home from being merely connected to being smart. You talk about speech and connectivity and vision and cognition on, yep, the Intel website and on some blogs you've written. Can you talk more about those areas, about specifically, you know, how Intel is sort of positioning itself on,
sure,
those lines?
Yeah, so I think, you know, what we've commonly said is we believe your homes today have gotten really connected. And, you know, I've given my personal anecdotes of how many devices I have in my home. It doesn't really feel very smart all the time. I can control all the infrastructure from inside and outside the home, but I'm still getting alerts throughout the day, and it just doesn't feel smart yet. So what we've really started to do is focus on how do you accelerate this transition from your home just being very connected to becoming more smart. And kind of what we have been focused on is three areas where the home really needs to become more perceptive to what's going on. And kind of rather than just the doorbell ringing and you get an alert that the doorbell's rang, to understand who's at the door, do you know that person, notifying the appropriate person in the home, not just, you know, blasting everybody a text. So it needs to be more perceptive. It needs to be more responsive and give you recommendations on what to do versus, again, just alerts. And then it needs to become more autonomous. And so what we have really been focused on is four technology pillars is to enable this perceptive, responsive, autonomous. You have to fix the connectivity in the home. That's kind of foundational. And I know we'll talk about this a bit more later as well. You know, many people are introducing the smart home technology into their home, and they've got 10-year-old Wi-Fi that was meant for a laptop, a tablet, maybe a phone or two, and now you bring 60 connected devices, completely breaks down your connectivity. So you've got to kind of future-proof yourself with your connectivity. And then it's the voice capability. I think we've seen voice becoming very popular in the smart home. It's made it so much easier to control things. But right now, it's often, you know, unless you're a geek like me and you have 16 of these echoes throughout your house, most people have one or two and they go to it to ask it to do something. Well, that capability should really be throughout the home so you can ask questions, get responses, control your infrastructure anywhere. So it's the connectivity, it's the voice. And then the next one is vision, you know, and that's a matter of the home really needs to have a better understanding of what's going on inside. And it could be with cameras, it could be with motion sensors, it could be with radar for privacy concerns or whatever, but it needs to know who's there, what are they doing, you know, did somebody fall? You know, there's all these things that you can really kind of help yourself with if you have this data. And so that's the third. And then the last one is just whether you call it artificial intelligence, but it's this local edge computing, which is a lovely term, I know, but it's, you know, you're gonna have all of these sensors in your home creating this rich data. It's not 100% practical to just shoot it all off to the cloud and expect a good response. You know, it's what can you do locally to learn about what's going on in the home, filter out the bad camera frames, and then, you know, send useful data up to the cloud so you get one alert on your phone versus 35 alerts. So those are kind of the four pillars we're focused on right now.
All right, well, excited to hear more about that. To move on here to Dan, you know, one of the really interesting things that Dan has been working on is he has a survey that they've done at Home Advisor of 1,500 American consumers in the smart home space, kind of asking about smart home adoption, what some of the barriers might be, what some of the concerns are, what people are excited about, and just tons of interesting data. I really recommend checking this out and giving it a read. One of the things that jumped out to me was that you sort of cite a shift away from DIY, or maybe not away from it, but a rise of the do-it-for-me style of smart home adoption, where people don't necessarily want to have to wire every gadget themselves and sort through the apps and figure out what works with what. They sort of just want someone to come and install it and make their house smart. Do you see that as a growing trend? Have you seen any other sort of signs of that or any traction with that type of business model?
We do. No, we definitely do. And just to quickly level set here, hopefully you're all familiar with Home Advisor, but just in case, we are a website and mobile app that connects homeowners and other consumers with home service professionals, so electricians, plumbers, architects, designers. We've got about 164,000 pros in our network currently. We're going to receive about 14 million homeowner requests this year alone. So we're really operating at a pretty sizable scale at this point. Back in May, our parent company, IAC, announced a merger with Angie's List, which is on track to probably close out at the end of the year. So that's going to, you know, certainly, you know, increase our size and scope. Obviously very, very interested in smart home technology. That's part of the reason I was brought in about 6 months ago to start to sort of build out the content on our site, really aimed at consumers as much as professionals. My official title is the Smart Home Strategist, so part of that is this content for homeowners, helping them bring the technology into their home. But certainly we're looking to set strategy for the industry as a whole, the professionals, but also manufacturers and retailers who are, you know, some of our most valued partners. So we've been starting to do the research. Sorry to come back to the question. So it started a few months ago. We did a survey of consumers, and yeah, that's exactly what we found. About half of them are looking for outside help. I think there's, you know, oftentimes smart home technology is marketed as a DIY solution. It certainly can be. You know, there are plenty of products out there that are do-it-yourself, and I think in particular with the sort of early adopter, which tends to be a more tech-savvy customer. But what we, you know, really learned resoundingly was that, you know, at least half of them are looking for outside help. So that was a consumer survey. What we're really here at CEDIA, you know, our big headline is a survey of professionals that we partnered with CEDIA on, and that was about 1,500 again. Pros from the Home Advisor Network, as well as about, you know, equal number of pros from CEDIA, and it was, you know, it was as encouraging, if not more. We found out, for example, that about, you know, across both groups, 75% of pros are now getting smart home requests from consumers on a regular basis, and that's defined as monthly, weekly, even daily. So super encouraging consumer demand, a real surge in consumer demand. So that sort of begs the question, well, is the service sector ready for that demand? And that's really kind of what we're, kind of the next step now that we have the data. Home Advisor is always kind of following the marketplace. So, you know, currently we don't have a smart home professional per se. We have electricians and plumbers and folks who are fielding these requests, but that's what we're, you know, starting to consider, you know, through partnerships with CEDIA, who, you know, obviously your members know exactly what they're doing. It's not that our handymen and electricians in the field don't, but they're hungry for more training and more education. That was another question in this, you know, more recent survey. And about 8 in 10 of them, both from CEDIA and from Home Advisor, said yes, we need more education, we need more training. They're looking for online videos, but even in-class training, they're willing to, you know, give up a day or a week or whatever it may be to get up to speed with this technology because they recognize, you know, the mass that's coming their way and are starting to sort of appreciate the opportunity. That really represents. So Home Advisor, we want to be there for our pros.
Very interesting. The studies you've done, you know, you also point to one of the big kind of obvious facts, I think, right now in the emerging smart home market, that millennials are really driving adoption. And as someone who, I think, barely qualifies as a millennial, the top of the range there, and, you know, has plenty of smart home gadgets in my home, I can attest. I mean, I can't tell you how many friends of friends will come up to me at home in Louisville and say, hey, I hear you write about the smart home. Which light bulb should I get? Which hub do I need? I mean, there's a lot of questions about the smart home right now, especially at the younger kind of millennial level. I mean,
yeah.
The study you have says that, you know, millennials, 77% have already bought into the smart home in some way. They bought an Amazon Echo or they bought a Nest. That's compared to 50% from Generation X and 25% from Boomers. So not terribly surprising there, you know, the younger being more tech savvy, but as that generation continues buying houses and new appliances, definitely I think going to be a boom in demand, as you say, for smart home help. So very fascinating.
Absolutely.
To move on to Josh here, not Josh, Alex.
It happened.
I knew I would make that mistake today. But you really are the face of Josh in a lot of ways. And you debuted Josh Micro here at CEDIA, which is just a sort of little speaker that has all the power of Josh AI in it, the sort of digital butler that you can talk to and give multiple commands at once to lower the shades, turn the lights on, play some music. And that was, you know, named a finalist for best new hardware, and then it won. I wanted to talk a little bit about that to start with. What was the what was sort of the thinking and the approach going into designing that product, and what niche are you trying to fill?
Sure. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Josh AI, we've been out for about 3 years now, and we started off really focusing on software. We had about 5 years of R&D before starting the company on building a language processing engine that is just really natural and able to handle all sorts of interesting commands, and it learns and adapts. And we decided to focus on the home for a number of reasons, least of which is myself and my business partner, we're both building homes and frustrated with what was out there. You know, the existing systems built some great hardware and there's a lot of fantastic solutions, but as software guys and experienced people, we thought voice control just made a lot of sense and automations and AI and learning. So we set out to start this business and in 2015 came to my first CEDIA and decided it just makes sense to focus on the pro channel. We want to make sure these systems are installed properly, they work right. With voice control, it's easy to have a system that is 90% configured properly, but that last 10% is going to leave your customer saying this thing is a piece of junk. And so the help of CEDIA installers and professionals means we can guarantee a great experience. So in 2016, last year, we debuted our initial product, which shipped on a Mac Mini, a central processor, that lived in the rack, and the entire experience was in the cloud. Or I should rephrase. We processed locally a lot, but the entire experience was a software experience. So you're using the apps, using tablets, or we hooked right into the Amazon Echo and the Google Home, and basically said, this is a way to get into the software that Josh enables. And over the last 12 months, we've been growing our dealer base, we've been selling more units, adding a lot of functionality. But the number one request has been for a dedicated smart home microphone, basically a far-field microphone, that is optimized for this channel. And what we realized was, one, we had to get off the Mac Mini. The Mac Mini is, you know, a great machine, but we use 2% of the processor. It's overpriced. You're subject to Apple's OS updates that you can't really opt out of completely. And it's this old model of having a processor in the rack that if it gets unplugged or anything goes down, your whole system goes down. Instead, we switched over the model so the entire server is now running on a little microprocessor that fits inside of a device about the size of a Nest thermostat. This device has a far-field microphone and speaker, so if you put one in every room or put a couple around the house, you now have a redundant network. If one of them goes down, the next one picks up, so you add a lot of reliability and stability. The next thing that we did was we put a bunch of sensors into this, because if you want to build a truly smart home, voice control is really just one aspect. We put in motion sensors, light sensors, temperature, humidity, a bunch of touch sensors. And the result of all these sensors is we can tie back into the automations, and we can enable a room where you walk into the kitchen, it detects someone's there, you just say turn on the lights, and the lights turn on. The next thing that we did is it has a touch dial, so it's a little circular ring that adapts to your latest command. So if I say to turn on the lights, it becomes a light dial. If I say to play some music, it becomes a volume controller. And so that dial is able to adapt to whatever command you're giving it. The system's also inherently localized, so it knows what room it's in. If you say, turn on the lights to the device in the kitchen, it turns on the kitchen lights. That seems obvious, but that's been one of the most requested features that's really hard to achieve with previous systems. This device is just loaded with a bunch of other aspects, but one of the other things we did was we made it easy to wall mount, and it's PoE, it's powered by PoE. And by doing that, it's really solving the custom home builder, the retrofit, and the installer demand of how you want to work with these products. So I can go on for a while. We've, you know, been sort of working for a long time without any sleep on building out the right features.
Yeah, I can only imagine. I do want to talk some more about artificial intelligence and voice control in general, which is sort of, I think you have a really, really obviously great perspective. You've been doing this for a while. You are just very accomplished in that field. What are some of the limitations right now with AI and with voice control that you are trying to work on at Josh that other people in that space should be focused on? And how do we get past those limitations and what can that lead to?
Yeah, so it's a great question, but I want to start with a little bit of the pros, because by understanding what people are excited about with voice, you can also understand how the limitations factor in. In terms of the pros, in our experience, it really comes down to four things. The first thing is voice control is inherently fast. So there was an Economist article out a couple months ago that said the average human speaks at about 150 words per minute, probably twice that when they're on stage, but you can only type about 40 words per minute. And so if you want to find a particular song or an album, maybe you want to watch a show like Mad Men in the Kitchen, it's a whole lot easier to speak it than it is to type it. So the speed is one aspect that makes voice really powerful today. The second one is it's just incredibly easy to use. We all know how to tell someone to turn on the lights or change the temperature. If you can talk to your house in that way, there's no learning, there's no training, it just works. The third thing is there's a wow factor. There's an emotional response to walking into a house and saying, I'm home, and the shades open, the lights turn on, you hear the thermostat kick in and some music plays. That response gets people excited. It makes all of this technology and all of this investment seem worthwhile to them. And the last one is it's truly enabling. When someone is physically handicapped or a little bit older, or maybe they just have a variety of reasons why using an app is just not the most convenient or the easiest thing, voice control enables that to give them power and access to control what they want to control. So those are the things that are really driving voice control in our experience on the pro side. The con side, of course, is people sometimes expect that this is magic. It's Jarvis from Iron Man. It's just going to interpret and understand anything you want. And you can't say, hey, Josh, make sure to feed the dog and close the door if it gets too hot. That's not just going to work if something isn't running the underlying system. That being said, I would say the reverse is probably more true. There are a lot of people who had a very poor experience with voice control in the 90s and early 2000s, and they say, you know, my car GPS is terrible. My first experience with Siri, it didn't work that well. And so people have this preconceived notion that voice control is just not going to work because of a past experience. And to that I say, give it a try, because it's much, much better than where it was in the past. The hardware, the software, the speech recognition, the neural networks, everything that's been developed in the last couple of years has pushed that much, much further. You still have some issues with accents, and multiple languages is definitely something that is needing to be developed further. But 12 months ago versus where we are today, there's a profound change. And so what I like to think about in terms of the problems and the areas that need to be worked on, without going into the nitty-gritty of every specific one, another quote from a publication, there's an article in the New York Times, this was maybe a year ago, that said, we tend to underestimate what's going to happen in the next 3 years, but we greatly underestimate what's going to happen in 10. And so if you think about certain voice commands that aren't natural or accents or voices that maybe don't work today, assume in the next 3 to 5 years, that's going to be solved. Guaranteed, a lot of those problems are not really that hard of an issue. It just takes time. And so in 3 to 5 years, it might seem like a long time from a technology perspective, but in the home automation industry and what we do, that's a blink. You know, that's tomorrow. And so think about this as a long-term strategy and try not to get too burdened with some of the micro details of what needs to be worked on today, because if you think about this with a 3 to 5 year long-term horizon, a lot of what we're not too happy with today, those issues are gone. And think about, what does that mean for your customer in 5 years? Where's it going to go?
All right, we will be talking more about that shortly, I think. But I want to move on now to the very patient Walt Zerbe here, been sitting at the end.
I'm always last, Z, right?
So Walt's got a long, very impressive resume, a lot of involvement. He joined CEDIA last March after 25 years in the home audio industry, roughly.
Yep.
And you know, he's served as a thought leader on numerous boards. He's won numerous awards. He was chair of the CTA Audio Division Board, member of the CTA Division Executive Board, member of CEDIA's Technology Council. And what Walt's doing now here at CEDIA is really looking at industry data to recommend different strategies that, you know, integrators can use based on those technologies that are, you know, emerging and evolving as we speak. So I think Walt's got a really kind of neat perspective on sort of the industry as a whole and how integrators and installers and the people on the dealer side of things can really position themselves well for the evolving market. So I just wanted to start there. You know, what sort of advice are you giving out lately, and what kind of questions are you getting from people?
Well, first of all, I want to say we get the unique and fun job of being at our interface with all of you. Okay. So technology side, the media side, the manufacturing side, and of course the installation side. Education. I can't say it enough. You got to keep your mind open. Hopefully this show has done some of that. If you've been in some other seminars, some of the themes are just, you know, you got to think differently. You got to open up your mind. What we're going to be doing is really preparing to help you prepare for this world. That is, you know, we touched on it a little bit, but the network is everything. So as we bring all these devices in the house, you better have a solid network to be able to handle all these devices. And I just don't mean Wi-Fi. It's power over Ethernet, as Josh just mentioned. It's Zigbee, it's Z-Wave. You know, there's multiple radio devices that are coming out, that are out now. That's really, really important that we have those inside our network. But we're going to be working on recommended practices to how to best prepare for this. Some standard work, if we can. You're going to be working on some standard work as far as the protocol level goes. But we do have a joint group that does ANSI, you know, standards through the CTA as well. We have an early warning system, which is called the Technology Council, which we use to discover things that are relevant to you and your business. Opportunity, threat, is it going to stick? Isn't it going to stick? Do I care? Do I not care? We have various vehicles to do that with, but that's kind of where we're focused right now. Cybersecurity is also high on our list. We're working on a white paper that will be talking about best practices, because this is a very, very, very key part of implementing all these devices.
Very glad you brought up cybersecurity. It's one of the topics I wanted to touch on today. So what are some of those best practices, and what can, you know, manufacturers and installers do to reassure consumers in an age when, you know, we just had the big Equifax breach this week, where, you know, millions of, I think over 100 million social security numbers were potentially exposed, and you see all sorts of hacks going on these days in terms of businesses and department stores and places people shop. So a lot of concern over connecting everything in our homes. And that might be a bit of an obstacle for adoption. How can manufacturers and installers overcome that? And what can they do to help reassure consumers that they're taking the necessary steps and performing the due diligence to make it safe?
How long is this session?
Yeah.
admin, that's the first thing I'll say, but that shouldn't be news to anybody out here. You know, password protecting things. In many cases, you're gonna need to get into VPNs, and you're gonna get into, you're gonna need to be able to segment your network so if something is, you know, bandwidth intensive, it doesn't take down other critical services like IP phones, when all the kids are streaming YouTube and when you're looking at the cameras at the door all over the place. Best practices as far as coverage, you know, simple coverage, knowing what your neighbors are doing, heat maps, you're gonna have interference of everyone's networks. Really understanding as on the manufacturer side, that's something we're entertaining as well. We don't really have any control on the manufacturing side. There will inherently be devices that are more secure than others. So we're looking into that side of things right now so we can interface with manufacturers to make sure they understand there are some real concerns and you need to try to make the best hardened product that you can make that has options to make sure it's secure when it's deployed in the home's network.
Okay, I want to circle back on this and talk a little more about security, but I want to open things up to the entire panel here and just talk about sort of the state of the smart home market. And you know, if you follow the news, if you read up on the smart home with any regularity, you've no doubt seen countless staggering projections about the future value of the smart home and where it might be within the next 5 or 10 years. You know, just in April, Zion Market Research pegged it at $53.5 billion by 2022. Then in July, you have Markets and Markets saying that it's going to be actually $138 billion by 2023. And just this week, actually, Manav Patek from Barclays was an analyst with Barclays was telling investors that the smart home market might be worth $300 billion by 2020. So just a lot of excitement and interest in where the market's headed. How much stock do you put in projections like that? And how much are those driving what you're doing in the smart home space, particularly with Intel and with Josh? What's sort of the forward-looking roadmap for where things are going to be and how you can be best positioned to take advantage?
Do you want to take a stab at that?
Sure. So I mean, I think the numbers are staggering, you know, per Alex's comment. I'm curious if we're underestimating or overestimating it. And if you saw Dave Evans' keynote earlier the week, he talked about, you know, how hard it is to understand these factorial growth, you know, expectations. I personally do believe it is going to be enormous. And that number, you know, that number is important, but what's hard in there is you've got silicon, you've got hardware, you've got software, you've got services. There's so many things that get bundled in there. I think it's going to be a huge opportunity, and I think that's why the scale piece of it is going to be so important. In order to enable that, you've got to have these scalable platforms and scalable software, which makes it easier for more and more people to participate. One other thing I'd like to say though is one of the things that we've been really trying to focus on is, and we've talked at a few different events here, and we've been talking a lot about user experience and research, and people are asking, why is Intel doing this stuff? There's a couple things. One is it takes a long time to design a chip. And so we're thinking out to 2021, 2022, what do you really need in your chip to process the workloads that are going to be happening? And one of the things that the research is showing us that we find really interesting is that there's a lot of value in home security and peace of mind and knowing who's in the home and who's leaving the home. Those are all really important things, and I think that's what people are naturally gravitating to. But also, if you talk about the smarts of the home, it's, you know, there's so many daily activities going on, so many daily chores that are going, that are taking families, and they all feel like they're working 80-hour weeks and shipping kids off to soccer, et cetera. What are the types of technologies and user experience that these, you know, high-end CEDIA integrators and installers can bring into a home that'll free up a couple of hours of mom, dad's time, free up a couple of hours of the children's time? And I think that's also really interesting as well. And the reason I brought that up is when we think of this, you know, $300 billion opportunity, does that consider those types of things as well? Or are they saying, oh, well, there's gonna be 50 million, you know, smart speakers sold, and there's gonna be 200 million smart cameras sold, and this many thermostats? I think there's gonna be new technology that's gonna be introduced solving completely different problems than we are really even aware exist today, so.
Yeah, from my perspective, there's both what's the prediction and where do you think it's going, and then more importantly, why does it matter? And so I'm right on board. I think the market's, and it's not even a thought, right? There's clear evidence the market is exploding, and this is not really a debatable trend, right? The smart home is a reality, and it's growing quickly, and it's coming. But why does that matter for both the integrator as well as the manufacturer? From the integrator's perspective, I think it matters in a couple ways, the first of which is that it transforms the way I think you need to think about your business. If every device is connected, the cost of each device is going to be going down, your margins are going to be going down, and your ability to make money on hardware is going to be going away. But you're going to have more connected devices that require a stronger network and more service and more attention to detail, because when products from Apple and Google and Amazon go down, your client's not calling those guys, right? You're not going to pick up the phone and say, hey, Google, my Google Home's not working. You're going to call your home technology professional. And so the business model, from your perspective, I think, needs to really shift towards, are your staff trained on installing these devices? Do you have a service plan? Do you have a monthly recurring revenue model? And are you equipped to handle an average home doubling, quadrupling, 10 times, you know, or adding an order of magnitude of devices in the home? What do you do if a home has 1,000 connected devices, and are you monitoring those? Do you work with Domots or IHIGI, or how do you do all that? So I think it's important to just think about how your business is going to transform as this change happens. From the manufacturer's perspective, it's a little bit different. We're currently a direct-to-dealer play. We do not sell directly to the consumer. We're not going through distributors either. If you want to work with our system, you need to be an integrator. And the reason for that is we're focused on the experience and making sure that the integration goes as well as it can. We work a lot on specific nuances for the client. And what that means is we're servicing the 1%, or the 1% of the 1%. And that makes sense when you're looking at the CEDIA market in the year 2015 or 16, but in the year 2025, everyone's gonna have a smartphone or a smart home. And what does that look like, and how does that change? And so we're constantly asking ourselves, as well as every manufacturer at the show, do we need to be going direct to consumer? Do we need to be going direct to the dealer? How do the margins work in both cases? If the integrator is selling service, do we need to have 50 points of margin? If we do have 50 points, how does that impact your business? And so we're constantly going back and forth, just thinking about, are we underpricing? Are we overpricing? Are we providing a product that enables you guys to build a business? Because at the end of the day, hearing about $300 billion sounds good, but does that put food on your table? Not directly. You need to think about how your business is really impacted. And that's really where I think it's interesting.
To glom onto that, I agree, it's exploding. I agree there's opportunity. And to your last comment, which I've been reframing it every time you say a sentence, because, okay, I got to reframe it differently. That's totally opportunity for you guys. You're the technical liaison between this stuff and the consumer. And there are so much option. It's mind-boggling. And they're going to need someone to distill down and a good empathy interview with your customer to find out how they live. What are their pain points? How can I solve them? Maybe you don't need this device. In fact, it's a bad idea if you get this device. Let's do this one instead. And that is going to be a super big skill and opportunity to straighten this stuff out for consumers, because they're head over the head right now. And it's going to continue to go that way, and that is a perfect role for the integrator to play.
So yeah, I'll just add one final point on this, referring back to our report. So I know, I realize the numbers are all over the place, but the figure we use is 30 million homes currently with at least one connected device. And to the title of this panel, the misnomer of the smart home. I realize just one connected device in the home does not necessarily make a smart home. Nevertheless, it certainly speaks to the sort of the oncoming demand. So one of the takeaways or recommendations, I should say, in our report to both CEDIA members as well as home advisor, electricians, and handymen, is the need for a really scalable business model. So in the report, we talk about the average CEDIA member revenue being $30,000 a project, I believe the figure. So it's that's a big project, but with a mass market consumer, it could be a $1,500 project. A handful of devices going into the home and paying for the service as well. So there does need to be a scalable business model. So we asked the question in the survey, and it was very encouraging to hear, even from CEDIA professionals, about 50% of them saying that, yes, we could take on a $1,500 job and still have a successful business. Of course, they're gonna need to supplement that with larger projects. But the need for that smaller, more scalable business, I think, is gonna be important as we move into the mass market.
You know, one thing that I've been keeping an eye on and been curious to see how it develops is the home building market in terms of, you know, as new homes are built, you know, if you think of the smart home as a utility sort of, as this experiential utility in a modern home, you know, a lot of people don't pick out their appliances, they don't pick out the sink or their bathroom, that's what they moved in with and that was what was there. Are we moving towards a time when smart homes are gonna kind of come pre-made or at least pre-configured for smart home tech? Are we gonna see sort of new approaches to building homes to be, you know, better suited to be smart? And if so, how will that impact what the business looks like?
So we're already seeing it. Lennar announced that they're basically underway on this project. They're only one home builder, but they're in the Fortune 500, so they're a very large home builder. It's going to be interesting to see how others react and respond. But in their particular case, they're picking a lighting product, a speaker product, a TV product, and they're trying to do the work of saying this stuff all needs to play well and should be easier to install because there's less variability. The result of that is you move in and you have a smart home. The question, of course, is homes are not a one-size-fit-all type, you know, environment. Things need to be customized and changed. I asked the question to them about, do you create a good morning and good night scene that assumes what someone wants in the morning and in the evening? If not, who does that work? How does that get modified? Are the, you know, is the software in play to give the homeowner that ability? Or is there a home technology professional? And how does that work when Lennar puts in 20,000 homes? Who's gonna service that? Is there a scale? And these are all problems and questions that they're trying to answer as well as others. So from my perspective, the answer is yes, yes, and yes. But the how and the what and the why is all, not really the why, but the what and the how are the questions that are still being addressed.
Yeah, and I think it's great as well because, you know, there's still many barriers to adoption for a lot of people to bring this stuff into their home. And if you work with the home builders, you know, one of the barriers is people don't know which devices to buy and what works with what. So if a home builder does it, they'll take care of that for you. Cost is also a burden, but if you work with a home builder and you can, you know, mortgage essentially the technology in your home, that's another benefit. But I agree with Alex. I think, you know, the challenges will be the future proofing. You know, I look at my house and it's 20 years old and I've got these big speaker panels throughout the house so that I could plug one AV in and it powers all these speakers in the house. And then if you go to the Bang & Olufsen booth now, they've got these amazing speakers everywhere and most of them are wireless. You know, or you see the house that's got the built-in TV cabinet, assuming you've got the 36-inch CRT tube, and then you're like, you know, all flat screens now and they're bigger and they don't fit. So I think it's fantastic that it's happening, but I think it's going to be a challenge to keep the homes up with the pace of, you know, the technology shifts going on right now.
Yeah, that being said, there is one builder, I don't remember which one it is, but they have decided on a platform. They've decided that HomeKit would be how they're going to go forward with automation. So there's that side of it too, but they've already announced any automation that goes in our house that we're going to offer, it's got to be a HomeKit style, you know, communicating device. So it's happening.
Yeah, I wanted to talk a little more about security and about concerns on that front. Any other thoughts? Just I know we had a couple of you weigh in on that, but is there anything else that you wanted to discuss about just the fears out there? Because that's one of the questions we get the most at CNET, is are these devices secure? Does it really make sense to have a refrigerator with an internet connection? You know, are my smart home cameras going to spy on me? There's, you know, horror stories of intercom systems that are, you know, being hacked and people are yelling at someone's baby. So what are the ways that the smart home market can, I mean, I know we talked about good password type protections and just basic best practices, but it feels like people have to know a lot in order to get into the smart home and feel comfortable with it. They have to know quite a bit in order to feel secure using these devices or feel like they're not just guessing. You know, when they're shopping for devices, they might see a couple of things on the shelf and they don't have any way of knowing which is the most secure. So what can be done in the on you know, the dealer end and the manufacturer side to help consumers kind of familiarize themselves with how to keep themselves secure? What can still be done?
Well, one is cloud versus local. Mm-hmm. And a lot of devices are direct to the cloud to be able to operate them and are very dependent on that. That brings about a whole, you know, opportunity threats of being able to, you know, have a breach or something. Even, you know, televisions we've read about have had this happen. Cameras, laptops, I mean, you're never going to avoid all of it. Nothing is hack-proof. And if anybody, I think we all probably agree up here, someone wants to do something badly enough, it can certainly be done. But there are systems that will do a lot of this work within the home and not have to keep pinging the cloud. Josh, am I correct in that you Your system does a lot of that?
99% of what we do is all local, but there's still a little bit of cloud.
Okay, so that, in my mind, seems like a step in the right direction as far as responsiveness and security, in that and traffic going back and forth constantly, if that's an accurate statement.
Yeah, well, one thing I'll throw out is it's a real issue and concern, but it also needs to be clarified to the consumer. If you were to tell people that we're going to put an always listening microphone and camera in their pocket to carry around at all times, people would say no, never. And yet we all do it. It's a smartphone. And when you think about what's going on currently with these always listening microphones, quite frankly, and I thank Amazon for a lot of what they did, but I blame them for that term, whether they created it or the press did, it's just not true. The device isn't always listening. It's waiting for basically a audible button press, which is the wake word before it streams any audio. And so people are saying, you know, this thing is in the room, it's always listening, I'm worried about having conversations around it. That's not necessarily a valid fear. The fear is it hackable? Could someone break in and be listening without your knowing? Potentially. As a home technology professional, though, you would be able to monitor and put restraints on the network, because streaming audio continuously over the network out to the cloud is a lot of bandwidth. That's pretty easy to regulate, pretty easy to see. And so in my experience with the consumers and the customers that we have, it's the job of the professional to tell the customer and the homeowner, you're secured, binary answer, yes or no. We've done the industry's best practices as we've been educated by CEDIA and others to do. The homeowner is really not, for the average homeowner is really not someone who's gonna be looking into the details of how or why. Same thing with banking. If you use online banking, you believe it's secure, you're transferring money, you're able to do a lot of things because you believe that the banks are trusted and there's also an insurance policy and all sorts of stuff. In the home, it's similar. We've not necessarily brought in new risk in the smart home compared to what's been around for quite a while, but the conversation and the fears have certainly gotten bigger. That being said, if something can be hacked, it will be hacked, and there's only a matter of time the latest Amazon Echo hack that came out, just to put it out there, are these non-audible voice commands where a very high frequency audible signal can trigger an Echo to basically register as hearing a command that could be an unlock the door or open the garage command, which is why these devices typically don't allow voice commands to do unsecure things like that. So long story short, the things that we can do and the homeowners can do include, as Walt was saying, more local processing when possible, make sure the online stuff is encrypted, don't use stupid passwords, use different passwords for different devices, don't use off-the-shelf, low-quality routers that cost $20, use high-quality gear. But at the end of the day, there's a reality that we need to change the mindset of the consumer, that the fears I'm hearing are not necessarily as warranted as people believe they should be.
There's also a whole another market opening up for firewalls. I don't know if we're mentioning brands or not, but I'm living with a Cujo right now to understand how that works. They're emerging because of this, and it's pretty interesting. I'm getting regular pings of my daughter's iPhone's doing this, my wife's computer's doing that. This threat was blocked. What you do beyond that, I'm not quite sure yet. But this is yet another market that's coming out to help facilitate and implement these devices.
Yeah, just to let you guys know, if you don't, Cujo is a really cool product and idea. What it does is, it's like putting a plastic bubble around your house. Anything that goes in or out has to go through Cujo. And so there are certain requests and commands that are going to be authenticated or expected. But if there's a surprise request or command that isn't, Cujo detects it.
Yeah, and I was a little worried about that being potentially a bottleneck, and it's not. I still have a 30 millisecond latency with this in, and it's not cause any problems.
Yes, these guys, I'm not a cybersecurity expert. These guys know a lot more. But I think this just really underscores the point we've been making throughout about the need for professional support here. And this is where the sort of do-it-yourself solution or argument kind of falls apart. It's hard enough to bring the right devices into the home and figure out if they're gonna, if they're going to work with other devices, to expect the consumer to then figure out encryption or, those types of, just forget about it. So that's where, bringing in a certified, qualified professional is really, I think, the best answer for most consumers.
You know, one of the themes we've kind of seen emerge in the smart home, I think, that was really pushed by Alexa and by a lot of the advertising behind the Amazon Echo, but is the idea of the smart home as sort of an experience, this experiential type of thing in your home. What sort of experiences do you think will be the most effective at driving adoption? What can still be done in terms of smart home tech that that might not, you know, people might not know about, that people might not know is possible? I think a lot about some of the audiovisual type of integrations, you know, the whole home audio and integrations with Netflix, where you can just, you know, use Josh to say, you know, play Mad Men or whatever, and just it just goes. People are starting to figure that out with Google Home and Amazon, but there seems like there's a lot more out there that hasn't really been tapped into yet. Where's the potential in terms of that experience of the smart home?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the term we've heard a lot in our research is, you know, you get this feeling like it's magic when you can walk in and you can make a command and things just happen. But I think what happens is that magic wears off unless it's truly delivering value. So as Alex mentioned, you know, if you can do something faster or more efficiently with your voice, people will continue to do it because it actually makes their lives easier. And again, and the all the research we have just shows it's got to be the longer term value. It's got to solve pain points. It's got to make your, you know, increase your peace of mind at home. It's got to ease in, you know, running the home, assist in your daily life, enrich the quality of your life. It's those types of things that I think people have people keep coming back and using the technology. I think that magic factor kind of does wear off. And I think what you'll find is a lot of times it gets introduced into the home, and the earlier in the adopter in the home who brought it in will use it all the time, but the other members of the home maybe don't use it as much because once the wow factor goes away, it's not worth it.
Yeah, I think to go, you know, we talked about the millennials earlier, and, you know, back to our survey, which found 77% of them are already in, and 20% of boomers. So kind of going after the boomers, we talk a lot about aging in place. I mean, there are so many smart technology applications there, from motion sensors, you know, certainly smart door locks for somebody who's, you know, perhaps arthritic or has other, you know, physical limitations. So, you know, thinking across demographics and, you know, really across the benefits beyond just the sort of convenience and security and things, the themes that we've, you know, hit and hit well, but thinking really from, you know, more on the full sort of life cycle, I think is important.
Yeah, I mean, there are a number of things. I'll try to keep it to maybe three. First one's definitely the audiovisual, and for that we look at it as really well implemented global search. When someone says, watch Mad Men, the system knows that Mad Men's on Netflix, and that's not pre-programmed. You don't have to customize that. You say, watch Man in the High Castle, it knows it's on Amazon. When I say knows, it's doing a search against all these different services, and it finds you the content. And the ability to just have global search that just goes and finds what you want without your having to even know. It's sort of the age-old question of which streaming service is able to play that content. It doesn't matter. If you just say play X and it works, you're happy. So that's probably one of the first ones that definitely is impressive to people. I will agree with the comment that the initial wow factor can wear off. I come from the social app space, the consumer space prior to this, where your focus is getting people to use your product daily. If you're using Snapchat every day, the company's, you know, growing. But if you don't use Snapchat tomorrow and you don't use it the day after, pretty soon you forget about it. It's not needed in your life. The thing I find about the less impressive voice commands is that they can be more habit-forming. So, for example, if you wake up and you say, you know, Alexa, turn on the lights, and they turn on, you're probably going to do that tomorrow and the day after. And next thing you know, you're doing it every single day. And while it's not seeming as magical the 20th or 30th time that you do it, it's now a daily habit-forming activity that becomes part of your routine. And that's really important. And I think we underestimate how impactful that can be in someone's daily life. The third thing is the custom integration stuff. It's amazing how a customer with a professionally installed control system is used to going on their app and setting their thermostat or setting their lights, but they forget it, and then you tie that into voice control, and they can turn on their lights and, you know, set their temperature, and they're happy with that. But they forget about the fact that you've got a Crest drum scene that's going to turn on your jacuzzi and, you know, get the bubbles going. Well, make that a voice command. It takes 10 seconds if you have a voice system. And now you go outside and you say, Josh, turn on the hot tub, and it turns on. And that's cool to people because they say, well, my hot tub's not voice controlled. How's that working? And people forget that anything that we can put on the network and control can be tied into a voice command. You can make a scene or hook it up one way or another. So we're seeing people really excited about voice-controlled steam showers, because in the old way of doing things, you go and you press a button, and then you leave because it takes 10 minutes, and you forget that you turned on the steam shower, so an hour later, this thing's been running. Now you say, Josh, get the steam shower on, and as you're getting ready, it's booting up, and by the time you're in there, it's just a seamless action. So it's the stuff that we've been automating and doing for a long time that you can tie into voice commands that I think are blowing customers' minds because they never thought about the fact that they could voice command and have their projector turn on. It's easy for us. It's amazing for a customer.
I think we'll be longer term moving into wellness in the house. I'm messing around right now with circadian rhythms, which is color temperature for light change, and I found that it has profoundly affected my day because I work in an office that doesn't have any windows, so my lights go from 2300 degrees Kelvin to 6500, so it gets yellowish to bluish white and back to yellowish. That kind of stuff is going to be with AI and with the sensors is going to be moving into the home to provide a better quality of life, air quality, energy management. A lot of these things are going to happen behind the scenes. It'll get to know you, it'll know the house, it'll know the weather, it'll know what's going on, and that will lead to a much better, healthier experience in the home, and that is absolutely going to be another side of this that is beyond the bell, the neat, I just did this thing.
It's automation, not control.
Yeah.
It's part of it.
Absolutely.
And I think another thing we can look to is kind of some of the trends coming our way, like, the sharing economy and more people, dual income families deciding to rent part of their house as an Airbnb, and then all of a sudden you need to think about totally different things. And we've actually done that in my house, and it's been profoundly beneficial to bring some of this technology in, because it could be a scenario where, we rent out the basement, but then I have to go on a business trip and my family's there alone, and I like the ability to know when people are coming and going, and sensors, and there's a bunch of things you can add there that will really make the life, better. And we have kind of a future vision video we share of some of the other complexities are when you do that type of thing, and let's say both people work in the home and you have people in your basement, and let's say something breaks. How do you automate things so that when I'm in a different state, we can contact home advisor, get a local technician to show up, fix it for you. All those things are a huge headache and a huge stress to deal with. And more people are going to start trying to do these things in their homes. So how can we start introducing things ahead of time, knowing that that's becoming more and more common?
Just to add one more thing. I apologize. I keep talking about voice. I was on a voice panel just before this, and my brain hasn't transitioned. But there's a lot more than just voice control. And there's a really good book that I recommend called The Best UI is No UI. And the example they give early on in the book is the car door. So in the past, you had a key on your keychain, you walk up to your car, you put the key in, you turn the key, you open the door. It takes a little bit of time, but it works, it's reliable, it can't ever go down. Well, there was a award-winning app at CES, I want to say in like 2010, give or take, maybe a few years earlier, where you can now unlock your car door with an app. And if you break down what this means, you're walking towards your car, you pull out your phone, you unlock your phone, you find the app, you open the app, maybe you have to unlock that again, you then navigate to the unlock button, you hope that you have a good signal, which you may or may not have if you're in a garage or a parking lot, you press the button, you wait for the thing to get the command from a satellite, the car door opens, you enter, it's really not adding efficiency. Well, what about voice control? Really not going to add that much efficiency. The solution, of course, is your key fob. You walk up, it detects you're there, you just open the doorknob and the door opens. We need that same set of sort of automation and just experience in the home. So in some cases, voice control is what you want. If you're watching TV, you need to get to specific content. But in other cases, the house should be using sensors and other data to just automate what you need for you. It should be predictive. It should be analyzing previous behavior to understand what it is you want. And in examples of where that's going today, if the garage door opens and the garage enters into the kitchen, put a little motion sensor and tie it into the system. So if the garage door opens and then you pass this motion sensor, close that garage door. There are a lot of these automations you can do today that just make the homeowner's life a whole lot easier. So don't think too much about voice as the be-all, end-all, because I apologize, I talked a lot about it. Think about how to remove barriers and make the experience just truly natural.
Yeah, this whole idea of whole house sensors sort of providing those advanced diagnostics. That's, you know, HomeAdvisor, we're really excited about that. And we've been really kind of trying to lay the groundwork through the development of a lot of really innovative on-demand technologies. I mean, that's kind of our whole business model. So we have like Instant Connect, for example. So that's where a homeowner can be on the phone with a pre-screened qualified professional within a few seconds, or instant booking where they can go right into the pros calendar and schedule an appointment. So we're at a point now with these APIs where we're able to, you know, have really valuable partnerships with Honeywell, with Amazon, with whoever it may be, because we really do see that as the future. That is, and the future is practically here. And again, it just comes back to the peace of mind with it's, so you've got a leak detector in your basement, that's great, but how great is it if the leak detector, when it, you know, notices water down there, can have a plumber or other professional, you know, on his or her way to the house within, you know, within a few minutes. So that's really sort of the future that we're imagining, that we're excited about.
So last question, kind of along those lines. Are there any technological advancements that you see on the horizon coming that you think will be especially beneficial to the smart home market that will really help drive things forward? So one that I might toss out would be better battery technology for, you know, sensors that can last years and years without battery changes, things like that. Anything that you see coming that you might be you know, predicting or even, you know, kind of positioning yourselves to take advantage of, or that you think has the potential to be transformative, anything like that?
I'll throw out one that's on my mind right now that we were talking about a couple days ago, is this idea of audio intelligence or analytics. And the idea is that your kitchen, for example, will have certain sounds that an audio microphone sensor is able to learn. So the faucet being running, the refrigerator opening or closing, footsteps walking in, maybe turning on the TV or sitting down in a certain chair. Some of these are going to be learned automatically, and some of them are going to be configured by a professional installer. But by using a microphone as a sensor, you can begin to really gather a lot of intelligence around, is someone in this room, how many people are in the room, what activities are they doing, and that data feeding back to the control system is, in my opinion, potentially really transformative, and it's not too far away from happening.
And that goes towards personalization of knowing that you're you and I'm me, which is huge.
Yeah.
So I think we'll have a lot of advancements in that side, as well as other sensors. I mean, they're using the disturbance of the Wi-Fi field to track motion and you know, notice that your shape. I'm shaped differently than my wife, and it knows that I, because of my mass as I move through, which is a little more mass lately, but whatever.
Smart home mask. Have you been losing weight?
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah. Anything else before we throw up to questions, or?
Just some cool, you know, AI applications for the service professional to, you know, to be able to provide remote service in ways that we, you know, I mean, it exists now, but it's, you know, there's just some very cool applications coming down the pike that are going to make it, you know, much more seamless and save the professional time and money, but also, you know, make life easier for the consumer.
I think that was a really important conclusion in the studies that HomeAdvisor's done, just the idea that there's this opening and this the position for a sort of smart home professional expert, sort of dedicated smart home expert, you know, because people are going to alarm companies and electricians, but there's not really that dedicated section in the yellow pages, so to speak, for smart home help. So I totally agree with that.
I'll throw out, I think it's important to also look at the opposite. There are technologies that are trending and getting a lot of funding that I don't think are necessarily going to be a huge deal. And one of those, at least in the short term, is VR. There's the prospect that VR replaces your living room, your home theater, a lot of what we do. And I'm personally making the prediction it's not going to have that type of impact. It might impact in other ways, but I think it's worth just looking at. Some technologies are very highly probable and important to think about. And in my mind, VR is not one of those categories that is that interesting, except maybe as a sales tool.
I think AR may be more interesting, the augmented reality side. The last thing I'll throw out is get gadgets. You have to get stuff, fill your house with them, play with them, learn them. That's your number one job when you leave here.
All right, so on that note, we have about, I think, 25 minutes left here on the schedule. Are there any questions from the audience for anyone on the panel here? Anybody have anything they want to bring up or ask about? You in the back there?
I can jump in with a quick response. So because we're operating as a control system, it's something that's really important for what we're doing, but we're not sending you data about everything that happens. We find that just information overload is a very real reality, and you need to be careful with that. But we basically have a log of everything that happens in the home so that it can be used. And an example of this is we had a client who wanted to do some of their own programming, and their integrator said, sure, go for it, but you know, if anything goes wrong, like, it's not on me. And so the client reached out directly to us and said, I can't figure this out, but at 3 a.m. my music's on, and this happened a couple times. What the hell is happening? And so we took a look at the logs and showed them how they could see their own logs, and we log every time a button gets pressed, a voice command is given, anything that happens is spelled out very clearly. The customer had created a scene that triggered 6 hours after sunset every day. And the scene was playing music. And so they would go to bed, and in the middle of the night, the music would come on. And in fact, it was easy for any of you guys as an integrator to have fixed because you would know the system and you're a licensed dealer. But the customer who wanted to go off on their own and go rogue, they didn't know. The logs were really how we fixed that. And when you have hundreds of devices and lots of users, logs are really the only way that you're going to be able to get down to those, you know, how to solve some of those problems. So I think logs are really important, and they need to be accessible to the people who need them, but I don't believe we need to burden anyone with sending out an alert every time these, you know, someone enters the kitchen, for example, unless you opt in. If you opt in for that, absolutely, that should be available.
Yeah, another question over here.
Just tying in a little bit and from the comments before about DIY versus integrator, you said about 50% is that a new study, and can you compare it against something like last year? Is it trending a certain way?
That was the first time we'd done that study. I will say that I've seen similar numbers over the, you know, over the course of the last couple of years. So my expectation is that it will continue to rise again as more mass market, you know, consumers come into this space who aren't necessarily as tech savvy, you know, the point I made earlier. So, you know, I'm definitely looking forward to doing the same type of survey next year to try to verify that. But, you know, that's not enough. If you guys have any other CEDIA's
got. No, other than it was a 2017 study, so it's extremely fresh information.
Yeah, and I think we were seeing kind of business model changes as well, because you mentioned retailers in the very beginning. I mean, you can see a lot of the device manufacturers are trying to really lower the price of their products so they can get more mainstream. That's making it harder for the retailers to make margin on these products. And so you're seeing the Best Buys of the world take their Geek Squad and turn them into smart home integrators. You're seeing Dixon's doing the same thing in the UK. And so I think they're looking at new ways of monetizing things, and then potentially on top of that, even offering longer term service revenue where they will come by and make sure your Wi-Fi is constantly up and running for a simple, you know, $9.99 a month service fee. And so I think there are people who are comfortable doing it themselves, but if there is this kind of step between going to a high-end professional, you know, integration and having, you know, your local retailer do it for you, I think there probably will be an increase in that happening.
Yeah, from my experience, a lot of the DIY products are standalone products where you can have just that, nothing else, and it'll work. That's a world where someone can set it up on their own and really get a good experience if they want to put in the time. But when you have a connected system and you have everything talking to each other, that's going to be really difficult for the average consumer. And so I imagine things moving the way that sort of servicing a car has moved. You know, everything used to be mechanical, and quite frankly, I grew up helping my dad repair the car and, you know, things I could actually do on my own. Now it's all digital, electronic. You go to a professional and, you know, you're happy to pay them the fee because it saves you time. I believe as more devices get interconnected and you have just a myriad of devices that need to work together, it's going to be hard for someone to just upgrade a single device and expect the rest of the system doesn't break.
And I think I'd echo what Dan said in terms of, I think there is a turning point that we're hitting right now where a lot of people that have been buying, you know, DIY smart home gadgets and things like that are early adopters who are pretty happy to troubleshoot and happy to sort of figure out problems. I know when I got my first Alexa product, an Amazon Echo, it was fun to try to figure out the best way to get her to understand a command that she might be tripping up on. I had a fun time, you know, figuring that out and getting it to work just the way I wanted. But then I bought an Amazon Echo for my parents, and they hated it. They didn't want to mess with any of that. They just wanted it to work. So I think there is a shift towards consumers like that. As more of those types of consumers are going to start buying in, that they're going to want a little more assistance and a little more help in terms of the do it for me versus the DIY approach. So I think that's we're going to see a tipping point here pretty soon, I think, as that continues. Any other?
I just wanted to get everybody's perspective on kind of the importance of standards and ecosystems as it comes to like the growth of the smart home. What your thoughts are?
Yeah, so I think it's extremely important. I think we need to get to a point where all of these devices can communicate with each other as well as communicate with the cloud, and they need to be able to do it securely and privately. And I think for the application engineers out there who are writing apps for these things, we need to make sure we make it easier and that you take on things like discoverability and onboarding and partitioning. There are things that can be done to create horizontal standards around that. And again, I think I mentioned at the beginning the type of role Intel is trying to play. So we are one of the founding members of the Open Connectivity Foundation. It's got about 400 members now, where we are working to take all of the fragmented ecosystems and try and break them down. You know, there used to be Allscene AllJoin that had Qualcomm and Microsoft, and we merged the two together. So now you've got GE, Intel, Samsung, Qualcomm, Microsoft, Honeywell, Somfy, just a slew of companies all under this one body, and there's continued focus to try and continue to break down the fragmentation. So again, it's just easier for all these devices to connect. And I think generally everybody agrees, because I think there's going to be the real richness will be when all of these devices can work together versus these standalone. You buy one product, it just does your temperature, and it doesn't tie into your shades, and it doesn't tie into all of your other infrastructure. So I think it's extremely important. I still think we're probably a few years away from it being really easy, though.
Yeah, I'll just throw out, I think it's important for the mass market consumer adoption and really seeing this reach a wider audience, but we've been working with devices that don't interoperate forever. You know, that's part of the magic of how do you make a 232 device with an IR, you know, and Wi-Fi, and everything just has to play well. And that's why we have hubs or control systems. And I think as we have better interoperability, there's going to be less reliance on the control system or the hub to do that part of it, and it changes the business a little bit. So there definitely is an impact on us. But my feeling is whether or not we see increased interoperability shouldn't have a profound impact on this channel too much. That's at least my hope.
Yeah, and I would think it's going to happen. It's always a good thing. But you're going to have a lot of new entrants that can't develop their own protocols and really don't want to develop their own protocols. So it's happened in the audio world for wireless audio. There's, you know, you can get into the game without having to develop your own synchronous audio stuff, which is a big, big task. So it's going to end up going that way. And it happened a long time ago with MIDI, which is still in use today, which is amazing. But anyway, yeah.
The reality is, you know, the parents might have iPhones, the kids have Android phones. If you're going with Apple HomeKit, you can't say some of you get to use the home and some of you don't. Everything is either going to have to work together or people are going to have to pick a camp. And I just don't think picking a camp is a reality in the home. You know, people are very diverse and you're going to have just a variety of different products. So if the Apple ecosystem doesn't interoperate with the Google ecosystem, I think they're basically not going to be part of the smart home. They're going to have to jump in at some point is my prediction.
I think it's a sticking point for sure, and I think that it adds another layer of decision making for someone who wants to maybe buy into the smart home. They don't have to think about, you know, only whether or not they want a motion sensor in their living room, but also, you know, what walled garden do I want that motion sensor to live in? And that's, you're asking the consumer to know more before they make a purchase, and that's going to be a barrier. It's more friction, so I think it needs to change in order to help kind of grease the skids. Any other questions out there? Yeah.
Given your comments about VR versus AR, where do you see AR coming into the smart home?
you want to handle that one? You're the specialist in that.
Yeah, so I definitely am more optimistic about AR, but I also don't think either technology is going to matter a whole lot in the next couple of years. AR is interesting when you think about what Microsoft's doing with some of their stuff from the perspective of, you know, getting your email, your calendar, camera screens, various visualizations to basically be in any area that you want to be. So for those of you who might not follow augmented reality too much, the idea is to simply augment your physical surroundings with a new surface. So in theory, if these were AR glasses, I could have this entire wall showing me a camera of my home right now, and that's cool, right? That's interesting. In all reality, though, I'm not placing a big investment on either AR or VR for the sake of the smart home in the short term. That's where I'm at.
I'm with him.
I'll give a quick plug to VR based on some personal experience with it. We're remodeling my home back in Brooklyn at Brownstone, and my wife and I couldn't figure out the back wall whether to do full glass or some sort of hybrid. So we did a couple of VR models, and to be able to walk through the space and sort of experience it, it really solved the problem for us. It helped us make the
on the sales side, and it may be on the sales side that you may employ some of these things in your businesses, in your demo rooms. It might be your demo room comes with you to the person's house.
It's a great point. I focus on the user experience, but the sales side, absolutely. That's a whole different story.
I also think there's a potential kind of along those lines with setup and the idea of being able to see what your system might look like before you install it. Be able to sort of figure out where a switch would go and then like have an interface that shows you how to connect things. I could envision an interface for the smart home that isn't on your phone or isn't a voice command, but is actually just looking at it and kind of seeing what's happening in a new way. There's some potential there, but I agree that it's a little murky in whether or not that'll catch on in any.
Yeah, and I think there might be a baby step of like ambient displays, whether it's because you don't want big screens everywhere because they look ugly, or it's the same thing, it just kind of augments the experience. You may be cooking and you can ask your device to show you a recipe, but if you can actually project on your surface and actually see it all, I think that may be easier, and it's going to be the same thing as like 3D glasses. I think augmented reality could be very interesting, but will the average person in their home want to put on a set of glasses throughout the day in the home for that experience? I don't know, maybe a bit out there.
I'll actually add, I'll take a step back. When I was saying that I'm not excited about VR or AR, that's really for the consumer, but it gets really interesting when you think about it from an educational standpoint. How often have we pulled up a YouTube video to see how do I set something up or configure something? You can imagine an AR reality where the integrator during setup is basically watching or being shown, plug this thing in here or wire this way, or this is not quite set up right. So I think for the sales, the setup, the visualization process, that could be really cool. I don't know anyone who's doing that, but I think it's a great opportunity.
And it doesn't necessarily have to be glasses. I mean, we're see what Apple does next week with the augmented reality that's supposed to be coming for the new generation of iPhones. But I can just imagine people holding their phones up and looking around the home and being able to see tips on where to put things and how to wire things. I think it's definitely possible. Yeah. So, next question.
And that's a good leeway. Like, what do you think are the social implications of this whole smart, even voice assistant, right? Because there are stories where the kids now are just yelling at us a few things. And then you used to teach kids discipline by having control, but very soon you don't even need to back into your own home. So, what are the social implications for our next generation?
It's a great big question. I think that in terms of the implications on people, I can echo exactly what you're talking about with kids. I have a couple of nephews that are pretty rambunctious, and whenever they're over, they love talking to Alexa. And it was funny because when they were babies, they loved playing with phone screens. They loved anything with a screen on it they wanted to touch as young as 6 months or so. But as they grew up, they really, really respond to voice. So I'm really curious to watch as the generation that's young right now grows up and voice is just a normal thing for them, and talking to automated artificial assistants is a normal thing for them. Just sort of what impact that has socially in terms of, how they communicate. So I think it's very hard to kind of quantify the way that tech that has a place in your home and you work with every single day, it's always going to be around you in your environment. I think that can definitely have a profound impact on people. So it's there's not a clear answer from that in my eye right now, but it's definitely a big question that I'm kind of curious to watch develop.
Yeah, so I have two comments. One is just, an observation in my home that I just found astounding is that I have an 11-year-old and a 13-year-old, and my beef with my older child when he got his first iTouch was he never really learned how to use a keyboard at that age. He was just texting away, and that was the frustration of the year. And then 2 years later, my daughter, you know, gets her iTouch, but Siri's introduced, and we have an Xbox that, you know, you can talk to. She never got very good at the, you know, the iTouch typing because she's used to talking to everything. So one, I just think it's astounding how fast we've made that. You know, your comment about the social implications, I mean, again, I think that's a huge question. I think I'll just give an example of a positive one that we have been hearing is, I do think the, you know, engaging with relatives and friends who are far away, if that can be done more easily. And again, this is what some of our research has shown for these people who are dealing with dual incomes, working all the time, busy activities, this idea of, you know, maybe grandma and grandpa can actually help the grandchildren with the homework, even though they live in a different state because there is this new technology that's going to allow them to do that. So I think there are some positive things that could come. I'm sure we can think of a million terrible social things that could happen, but you know, I think there's some goodness too.
Yeah, along those lines, I think that the impact on senior living, on living, the idea that a smart home can help you live independently longer, I think that could be pretty transformative and pretty great. Couple that with self-driving cars, I think there's just things are looking up for older.
That's what I was going to say, as well as just monitoring, you know, knowing that your other loved one in another state is actually moving around and okay. So there's going to be a whole new category that's going to come out of this.
So these guys are inherently optimists, which I think is a nice view of things. I don't watch a lot of TV, but if you watch the show Black Mirror, every episode is a reality that could happen, and a lot of them pertain to what we do. You know, you could have a voice assistant that learns your partner's voice and you think you're talking to them and they're not anywhere around. You know, that's a very real reality that's not too far off.
Why? Because they push a button. Everything they do, like, well, why would I do it that way? This way is easier. It's about easier, easier, easier. Yep. They don't care how good it is. It's good enough, and it's easy. And so I think that's how we have to look at most people now. Some of our remotes at home, I'm like, I don't know, right? They just want to hit the button, they just want it to work. Right? I don't care what is the best. They just want it to work. I think that's where we're learning.
While I agree with what you're saying, and it's definitely true with the next coming generation, I still think the clients that are going to be paying our bills today do care about the quality. And I think we're going to see quality and convenience really converge in the future.
That also goes implementation of building the brand. You know, your business is you. It's not the stuff that you sell, and it's how you put it together and how it works, and solving that problem for the end user. So that is a reason why you should all exist, is to make sure that it is convenient, it is reliable, it is secure, and it works well. And that's why selecting what you're going to use and how you implement it, and is it really what the customer wants, what the customer needs, and are you helping them improve their life? Very simple.
But this is a great question. Is my smart home making me dumb? I mean, if you see the article kind of every few months in the New York Times or other places, and you know, it's a fair question. I think of it with a lot of the smart cooking gadgets that sort of, you know, take the guesswork out of cooking. But are you, you know, wouldn't it be better to learn how to cook? You know, you could argue, and yet I think a lot of them, it's almost like having a teacher, you know, somebody walking you through the process, so that eventually you reach a point where you are actually learning how to cook. But it's a really good question for sure.
And that happened with speed dial, by the way. When speed dial came out on phones, I forgot people's phone numbers because they had them programmed in speed dial.
It's probably time for one more question here, so let's go ahead and.
Actually has many updates on how she has found Alexa, not this
good question.
I'll just quickly throw out that I spoke to someone working on this space yesterday, and her, the reality of what she found was a lot of these customers don't have a lot of money, and a lot of these products require people with a lot of money. And I think we're going to see the pricing come down and the availability go up. That doesn't answer your question how to find them. It just means I think it's currently a small market that's going to be growing in terms of the products that are priced accordingly to who needs them.
I have a suggestion. Your local community, you should be interfacing with the builders associations, the architect associations, and all the people that are building the facilities. There's definitely going to be a huge market for technology and aging in place. Give talks about technology, you know, hobnob and meet people, network. There's and for a lot of you guys, your businesses are going to change because of all this stuff. And that's exactly the right kind of thinking. You just maybe get involved more in the local community to figure out how to make these connections.
Yeah, I'll give one more plug to our study. We found how many a large percentage of non-smart home projects leading to smart home ones, and it just makes the point that smart technology is being sort of, you know, integrated fully into the remodeling experience. So to that point, there's something called CAPS, Certified Aging in Place Specialists, in the remodeling and building community. So sort of forging relationships, partnerships with those folks, so that, you know, you're in a position to provide the technical know-how as they're designing these spaces. It's, I think those types of relationships are going to be ever more important as we move forward here.
All right, well, let's squeeze one more in. Yeah,
I'm in that elderly space, and the challenge we have is 80% of them don't have Wi-Fi.
Yep. So 5G.
It's an opportunity.
When 5G starts going around everywhere, which has huge bandwidth, and we could even go IPv6 and all this other stuff, the connectivity will happen. But yeah, that's a real thing.
Yeah, and I guess I'm completely out of my area of expertise here, but I think the other thing, again, if you saw Dave Evans' keynote, you know, the population is getting older, and I think, you know, the community that you do service with your high-end installations, more and more of them are going to be dealing with parents who are aging, you know, so there is potentially a channel that you already have that could be interested in future businesses where you could go and do an installation for their aging parents that could tackle their Wi-Fi and install this technology for them, so...
That's a great point. If you look at any of the commercials for the Amazon Echo Show, they're all about parents. They're all about people getting it for their aging parent to talk to their grandkids, or to, you know, to live more independently in their home, or, you know, just to make chores easier when they're washing dishes and they can use a voice command to turn the lights on. So I think that idea that going kind of to the kids and saying, hey, do mom and dad need help? We can help out. I think that could be an avenue in for sure. Well, I think that's going to wrap it up for us. It's right at 12:30 here. Time for lunch, perhaps. Thank you so much for all of you, for all your great questions, and for listening. And thanks to our panel. Great job. Really
thank
appreciate
you.
Everybody.
Thank you for your time.
Yeah, awesome.
Thanks a lot. Have a great rest of the show. And a safe trip back.